As she introduced, my name is Paris, and as you know, the introduction says, I'm a mental health professional and an academician. I don't like to use the word entrepreneur, but I've also started an initiative, and I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about that. But primarily, I'm here to talk to you about what are the biggest problems that our country is facing. And if you ask me, I think it's not just a problem, but it's also a basic human rights issue. Now, I want you to just suspend your imagination for a few seconds right now. Yeah, just work with me. So imagine that there is a problem that affects 20% of all Indians. Yeah, you know, a couple of talks ago we heard we are 1.35 billion people in this country. Imagine 20% of that population is affected by a problem. Yeah? Now, we heard, you know, 6,500 buses. Imagine that there are only 5,000 professionals who can help these 20% of Indians who are affected by this problem. Yeah? Do the math here and you will see that the ratio is really, really screwed. Yeah? Then, let's go imagine further. Imagine that nearly 8 out of 10 of the people who are suffering from this issue are never going to be able to access help. 8 out of 10. So that's 80% of people who are affected by this problem never getting access to help for it. Now the ones who are lucky enough to get help, they're going to face stigma, shame, and taboo for no fault of their own. Yeah? And while they are seeking this treatment, they could risk losing everything. You could lose your accommodation, you could lose custody of your children, you could lose your property, you could lose your driving license, you could lose your bank account, you could lose your even most basic human rights. Now this sounds like something out of Black Mirror or some dystopian fiction novel, but this is actually the reality of mental health in India. Mental health in India is not just one of the most severe, but it's also one of the most ignored and underfunded areas in our country. And there are some problems why this is, apart from what I just told you. So it gets worse. Yeah? So how does it get worse? Most mental health professionals, outside of a few select cities, you don't find anyone. So you can find most mental health professionals, you know, in Mumbai, Bangalore, Kolkata, Chennai, and obviously because these mental health professionals are only available in select metros, the cost of mental health is really, really high. If you've ever gone for a therapy session, how many of you have ever attended a counseling session? Gone for a counseling session, not your engineering admission or anything, psychotherapy, yeah? The average therapy session, correct me if I'm wrong, is anywhere between 1,000 rupees to 5,000 rupees for an hour. And if you are unfortunate enough to require therapy sometimes, I mean, I don't think it's unfortunate, but if, you know, mental illness is a serious thing, but if you require mental health support, approximately you'll need a therapy session once in 2 weeks or maybe once a week. Now imagine 1,000 to 5,000 rupees once in a fortnight or once in a week. That's a lot of money, yeah? Now imagine you don't belong to these select metros and you need counseling. There's a problem because the mental health professionals are not there and they're not available online either. So you can't really connect to them unless you travel really, really far. Now that makes it even worse. Now, even if, you know, you're somehow able to find a mental health professional, even then, the training is very, very specific, you know. Most of us mental health professionals are trained with textbooks which are written in the US or the UK. So they're not really cognizant with the Indian context. And in the Indian context, they'll be able to understand very select upper class, upper caste, urban English speaking population. If you don't fall into those categories, chances are that the mental health professional is not even going to be able to understand your problem. And somehow through all of this, if you still find a mental health professional, you don't know the quality. Because unlike many other professional and applied disciplines, there is no regulation of quality. So some mental health professionals like me have a master's degree, which is a 2 years applied program where you undergo rigorous training, supervision. But some of us are also people with a 2-day weekend program, which they paid like some 5,000 rupees for and they're just practicing out there now. So you don't know which one is which. Quite often. So all of these are huge problems, and me and a lot of other mental health professionals have been working on this area for quite a few years now, and three areas are primarily identified as challenges which this sector is facing, and we're trying to work on them. So how do we make this work? You know, so number one factor which all mental health professionals, all community mental health professionals seem to agree on is that mental health care needs to be accessible. So you shouldn't have to travel long distances to access mental health care. It should be accessible to you where you are. Isn't that logical? Yeah. Secondly, it should be affordable, right? So you shouldn't have to reach a point where you are able to afford healthcare. Healthcare should be available to everybody. It's a universal human right, isn't it? Should it be that only the rich have access to healthcare and the poor don't, right? Or if you can afford one therapy session a month, you should only take one therapy session a month, and somebody who can afford once a week should do once a week. That's not okay either. So the second thing is affordability, yeah? And the third thing is it should be politically informed. Now, I'm not talking about BJP Congress kind of politics. I'm talking about contextualizing therapy. Most of the time, what's happening is that therapy is trying to fit the person into the system, as if something is wrong with you. But it doesn't take into the account how the system affects you. So therapy shouldn't try to fit you into the system. It should try and understand how the system affects you and try and change the system. That's what therapy should be ideally trying to do. Now the problem is that to do all of these three things and to do it in a sustainable manner is extremely difficult. So most mental health care services in India, if you see, are either provided by the government or non-government organizations who are doing it on a charitable basis. You don't see any chains of mental health because it's simply not a profitable business to run, right? But we try to change that. We're trying to do something called the alternative story. I mean, as the name suggests, we try to do something different. And what is this different thing that we have been trying to do? Not here to promote the brand or anything, but I'm just trying to tell you how we have attempted to change the scenario and how we have fared in our attempts to do that. So when we started the alternative story, we believed in three core values. We said that this service should be something which is sensitive, which means that it should keep people who are at the margins of society in the focus of therapy. So you understand, people who are at the margins of society are actually getting ignored. Here we said, let's make a service which focuses on the people. Because if you see statistics, you will see that people who belong to these communities, people who have faced trauma, people who belong from gender and sexual minorities, people who belong to religious and impoverished groups, people who belong to the Dalitums in Adivasi Samaj, have the highest requirement of mental health care and the lowest access to it. So the service that we started, we said it should keep this group of people in the focus, because everybody else is going to find a way to find mental health services one way or the other. The second thing, we said that it should be robust. Remember I mentioned about quality. We said that quality is suspect. So we said that a service like this should not compromise on quality of services. So we have to be strong in our theoretical understanding. So we know what we're doing. We know what we're talking about. In counseling, we say that there are two important principles. I'm not going to bore you with the technical details of it, but these two important principles are very important to know. One is called beneficence, which means no matter what you do, always try to do good for the client. But there's another principle which is more important than that, which is non-beneficence. If you can't do something good for your client, don't do further harm. Right? So we try to keep our theoretical knowledge as strong as possible, and we try to also keep our technology. You guys are technology people, you'll understand this better. That if somebody's coming and talking to you about something as personal as a therapy session, you need to keep the technology extremely, extremely secure, right from the payment details to the appointment details to the data which is recorded during the session. So the technology also we use ensures that it keeps the confidentiality intact. And the third thing, we also had to be was smart. Why smart? Because, like I said, this isn't a problem which seems to have been cracked yet. The problem of making this ethical and affordable, but also sustainable. So we had to be smart. We had to come up with an idea which made it accessible to a large number of people, but we didn't go broke either. So we started something called as the Pay What You Want Initiative. Now think of the Pay What You Want Initiative like a modern day Robin Hood scheme. We take from the rich and we give it to those who can't pay the regular cost of therapy. So remember I said that an average therapy session costs anywhere between 1,000 to 5,000 rupees. So firstly, we started off keeping the service at full price as low as possible. Yeah, when we started off, it was 1,000. We said, let's keep it as low as possible. But with Pay What You Want, we decided to bring that even lower. Because when I asked different people, what do you think is an affordable therapy session for you? I didn't get one answer. So I said, I shouldn't be deciding that for people. It should be at the cost that you can afford. So with Pay What You Want, we said, let's keep it at 1/5 of the cost of a regular therapy session. And if you can afford that, great. If you can't, we'll still find a way to make you accommodated. But most people we found were able to do that. So we started off dedicating about 1/3 of our therapy sessions every month for people who could access it under Pay What You Want. And this somehow allowed us to run the services in a profitable manner. Now let's see how we have done and what we are doing right now. If you come to the alternative story, you will obviously be able to get online and offline sessions for therapy. So that means we don't believe that you need to come to our office to attend a therapy session. You can be where you are and we will still attend to you. So we have people from different parts of the country and different parts of the world who are able to access us at whatever price point that they are able to. Secondly, there is group therapy. If you are not comfortable talking about it alone, and if you feel there's a strength in numbers, we do that. There are workshops, so that we get people together who are going through the same issue, and we talk about this, we share ideas, we share strategies. Training and supervision is a big point. Most therapists who are even training to be therapists don't get supervision, and they don't get quality supervision, so we are trying to do that as well. And of course, we're working with organizations, because organizations also face a lot of troubles, a lot of stress. How have we done so far? We're not a very old company. We haven't even been around for 2 years, and we're completely bootstrapped. But even with something as taboo as mental health, we've been able to do more than 10,000 consultations in less than 2 years. That's a big number in terms of people coming forward and talking about mental health. In terms of where we are, we've been able to expand our team to Bombay and Bengaluru. We started off as just me doing weekends, and today we have a team of 8 full-time therapists. And the next part is what makes me proud, that we have an equal number of trainee therapists who will soon become full-time therapists with us, and this is going to double the impact that we do right now. And this is the most heartening factor, which tells us that Pay What You Want has worked. Right now, if you go and look at any of the counselors that we have on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, there is 100% utilization. That means that every therapist, every available slot gets utilized, which means that people are coming forth and using these services. So does this mean we've cracked the problem? You know, it doesn't mean we've cracked the problem. This is one initiative. You know, it's something, we are one bootstrapped company. There's no VC money here. We're not going and pitching to investors. We don't have millions to raise or anything like that. And the talent pool available also is not as robust as some of the other industries. So it can't be scaled at the same level as your other startups. But this is an initiative. This is an initiative that promises that it is possible to keep those who need mental health care in the focus, do something smart, do something innovative, and make mental health care accessible to all. But this is not the only solution. The hope is that more of you start talking about mental health. The hope is that more of you demand mental health care where you are and at price points that you can afford them, but that more of you are interested in the quality of the services, so that, you know, we can't just have people with any kind of background delivering therapy and doing damage to people. And when we do that, we will see that the government takes more interest. We will see that the private sector takes more interest. And hopefully then we can go towards making this dream of making mental health care affordable, accessible, and available to all. That's my time. Thanks a lot.